Welcome back to The Big Issue. My name is Mubarak Mugabo. Now, this week or last week, we lost General Eli Tumwine, the former security minister in the government of Uganda, also former member of parliament representing the Uganda People's Defense Forces in parliament. Also, recently, we lost a former minister of cooperatives, Yona Kanyomozi, who also served as the Uganda's representative at the East African Legislative Assembly. Some of these leaders have been around, and this is a breed of the post-independence leaders. Will their legacy be upheld by the new breed of politicians, or do career politicians really have what it takes to move on and also to take on the mantle, to move on with the legacy that they have left behind? That's the discussion that we want to interrogate in today's Big Issue. Joining me to do that are two distinguished guests, Tony Geoffrey Owana, veteran journalist in studio, will be joined by another guest later in the show. Tony Geoffrey Owana, very good morning and welcome to the Big Issue.
Be blessed.
let us start with the issue. We have two gallant sons of this country. We lost them, they died, they passed on, General Eli Tumwine and former cooperatives minister, Yona Kanyomozi, I beg your pardon. These are leaders who have been around and you can never wish them away from the politics of this country. What does this mean to Uganda and what would you talk about these two gentlemen that we lost as a country?
First of all, thank you, Mubarak Mugabo, for remembering that I existed and you invite me here. I used to enjoy sitting here until you made your decisions to do things. I have to tell you that. Yeah? So your sins are forgiven.
All right, amen.
Now, why would we have a discussion on people dying? They always die. It is not striking that they have died. We have lost many. And the sky didn't fall. However, that does not mean that we are not feeling the loss. Yonasane Bankobeza Kanyomozi does not belong to the Tumwine generation.
Yes.
I think Yonasane is even older than the president, Museveni. Although I think they belong to the same league.
Generation.
I first knew Kanyomozi when he was Minister of Cooperatives and Marketing, I think during Binais. I don't remember very well whether he was minister during Rule, but I wouldn't be surprised because his whole life, we had the happiness to interview him with you remember?
That was 2018, around there. Yes.
And I hope you kept that interview.
It must be there in the archives of the New Vision.
When you say must, because yeah. They say if you don't inspect, don't expect.
It is there. We shall actually bring that interview back.
Because Kanyomozi told us a lot of interesting things. Political. Economic, personal.
Yes.
You remember when he said, when did he first put on shoes? I think he was in S3.
Yes. Senior around 4, actually.
S4. That's when he first put on shoes. And it was not because of poverty at home, but shoes were not really, they were really for a selected
group
now,
of students.
Now, Bankobeza came up that way. He became synonymous with the cooperative movement. And although he himself was passionate about it, the circumstances under which he operated, militated against, especially the cooperative movement, could have still gained a lot from Yona.
Yes.
Especially when he was working on things like coffee, cotton. You remember he told us they had even started a private...
Cotton...
And coffee.
There were some, is it milling or what?
But then
they wanted to roast actually the coffee.
What happened was that the government of the day was interfering with the cooperatives. It is very good to be guaranteed pay, that the government will pay the cooperatives. How about when it doesn't pay them? Mm-hmm. So people today are talking a lot about how they lost the cooperatives. Mm-hmm. But let me tell you this straight. Even Kanyomozi said it, you remember, he said, cooperative societies don't belong to the government. Today, people are asking the government to set up cooperative societies. Mm. To cooperate with who? It is Mugabo or Anna who will sit down and say, let us cooperate on journalism, if that's what we are saying. Mm. Government can only license us and facilitate us here and there, but the business of cooperating. Mm-hmm. That's why the cooperatives that were strong have remained.
Yes.
Others say, like around this territory, they say, when you lost them.
You have a right to cooperate, you have a right to associate.
But once you prevent people from selling what they produce and you want to buy it as a monopoly, they get frustrated.
Yes.
So, when we liberalized and cooperatives lost their grip, and that's what was paining Kanyomozi, the people who had produced to sell were happy. Because now their coffee did not belong to Coffee Marketing Board. It belonged to them. The other time, selling coffee meant you were a smuggler, even if it is your coffee.
Yes.
But the Kanyomozi story is quite long. Mm. And he has died at a time when, a bigger sounding gun. Mm. But he's well connected.
What do you mean?
Yona. Mm. Yona is a friend of the president.
Yes.
They had differences of opinion. One became a minister in a government which another one was fighting.
Yes.
But they had served other governments together.
Together. Mm.
Two, Yona, I think, is he the uncle of Jenomuntu?
Jenomuntu. Mm-hmm. Mujisha Muntu.
Now, I remember a function when they brought back the remains of Jenomuntu's father.
Mm. Muntuyera.
Enoch Muntuyera. Mm. He was accorded a state funeral in 1983.
That was Obote II government.
Yes. Mm. And at that time, Muntu was busy fighting the same government
of his father.
Yes. And those are the contradictions.
Yes.
But Yona, let his soul rest in peace.
Also, actually, the president talked about Yona's contribution in the Nairobi, that sometime when the president used to go there, he would pass by Yona's home. That's the statement that the president made yesterday. But also I want to find out from your perspective, what should the country learn from Jeno Tumwine, for that matter, because he's going to be late today in Mbarara, in Kazo district. What should the country learn from Jeno Tumwine?
I really don't know whether what we call the country wants to learn anything. Mm. No. First of all, I am happy. Mm. I am happy that we have had people celebrating his death. Mm. And they are very happy. Mm-hmm. At least on their faces, I can see they are happy. I can see. This one. Mm. There's a lot of
social media
happiness and partying, and there's a leader of a political party who immediately organized the victory party at. I wish you could hear that song.
We will get back to there, but we just want to talk to. We are actually discussing, the leaders that we have been able to lose, but also the current breed of politicians, whether they can as well take on the mantle from where the Jeno Tumwines and Yona Kanyomozi have left to another level. We just want to be joined by Professor Maurice Ogenga Latigo, former leader of the opposition and also a former member of parliament representing the people of Agago. He's joining us live on Zoom from Agago district. Professor Maurice, a very good morning and welcome to the Rush Hour.
Thank you very much, and
Professor.
Let me start by, yes.
Please go ahead.
Yes.
Please go ahead, Professor.
Let me start by apologizing. I am in the village where our mornings don't start in offices and studios. They start on the farm. Yes. So I was more preoccupied with preparing to go to the farm, only to remember that you had invited me for this. So I apologize for that.
It is all right, yeah. Professor. We the country lost General Eli Tumwine. I know you served with him in the Ugandan Parliament for quite some time. But also the country lost former Minister for Cooperatives in the UPC government, Yonah Kanyomozi. First of all, tell us about these two gentlemen and your first encounter with both of them.
Well, let me start with the late General Eli Tumwine. May the good Lord rest his soul in peace. We were actually undergraduate students together in Makerere. Same year mates, we stayed in Lumumba together with people like Kainda Otafire, Chapa Karuanga, Kagata Namiti. And that time he was a quiet, more or less reserved fellow. He did his arts, he had his cameras. During Amin's time, owning a camera was also a big thing, and he used to do photography, etc. But he rarely engaged in collective discussions amongst us. And then in Parliament, we served, we knew each other, we chatted each time that we had opportunities, and we kept our relationship quite well. And it is tragic, but it happens that he has passed on, and we thank God for the services that he rendered to our country. Yona is somebody whom I got to know very well from the times of Obote II. I then had moved to Nairobi, but we established our relationship when Professor Dipale Kwamu and Ben Kereche contested the UPC presidency of Makerere. I had to come from Nairobi to come and manage the campaigns of Adipale Kwame. It was a very intense campaign. Everybody was involved. And then after that, I became close with Yona. Occasionally would meet at the home of Adonia Tuberondwa with Katabeliru Amoti and some other UPC guys and talk over things. But the bigger political engagement with Yona was when in 96, Semugere decided to contest for the presidency under IPFC. And Semugere invited me and said, "My son, I want you to help me." I was in Makerere, but Semugere and my late father, Gino Bonyo, who was PPMP for my area, were colleagues, close colleagues. So we joined in that campaign. And that is, I was in charge of security. That is when we worked very closely with Yona. We went to every inch of Ankole with them and Professor Rubahayo. And then we went throughout the country with Cecilia Ogwal and all these people. Mm. After that, when that politics passed, as a consultant, we did consultancies with Yona. So we knew each other very closely.
Professor, thank you so much for that recap of what your first encounter with these two gentlemen. But I just want you to actually give us your opinion and the views of the type of the politicians that actually, there seems to be a generation of politicians that we're having today, and that generation of Yonah Kanyomozi and the rest, the post-independence.
And him.
And you, actually, the post-independence leaders. Would you give us a very clear comparison between the two crops of leaders, the ones of post-independence, that the one with the one that we are having today?
Well, the the post-independence, the pre- and post-independence politicians and the leaders that followed immediately up to the time Amin took over power and even after, were really people who were in politics, driven not by self-interest, but by the bigger interest of the country and the desire to play their role. And a lot of us really felt beholden to the country for the things that we received as young people and as people in government or civil service in private sector, and you feel obligated to give back to the country. The times have really changed. I mean, the best example I can give you of that difference is when one day I was in parliament and the sugar bill was being debated. I didn't even know that people were being paid, to push for particular elements in bills. I was shocked. Mm-hmm. And an MP was looking for his colleague who apparently had taken money to push a particular instance. Asked for that colleague when I was up at the parliamentary canteen. And I had seen the colleague and I said, oh, he passed that way. And then the guy turned around and said, oh, professor, we don't see you, but we understand. You are the ones who inspired us to join politics. Uh-huh. But you don't belong to the parliament. For us, we are here for the money. A colleague telling you that in parliament was a shock for me.
Professor, we'll just keep online. We're actually going to come back to you. We are here with Tony Geoffrey Owana, veteran political journalist. Let's start from actually where the professor has stopped. Give us your comparison between the likes of Professor Latigo, the likes of Yona Kanyomozi, the likes of Paul Ssemwogerere, and the likes of the politicians that we're having today.
Mugabo, I am a student of the history of this country, but I just didn't know that Professor Latigo was the son of Gino Obonyo. I've just learned it now.
Son-in-law.
Even that I didn't know.
Yes.
So I have learned something this morning. Thank you for inviting me. Mm-hmm. You see, we are not going to force you to learn anything from your seniors. All the opportunities to pick what you can pick are available. You are refusing. Mm-hmm. This government made a mistake. Oh, sorry. This government removed the 5 killer diseases, which is why all of you are around. And you are healthy, and you are educated, but you prefer not to learn from your seniors.
Which was their responsibility anyway. Mm.
No, the 5 killer diseases, we are not consulting anyone. They were just attacking. Mm. Uh-huh. And we are there for a long time. They were a good check on noisy youth. Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. But now you are around. Mm. And instead of learning from the Latigos, the Owanas, you are just making noise. Once you assume that you already know, you can't learn.
That's true.
You simply can't learn. Mm. You people talk a lot about mentorship. Do you want it? As the professor has just said, an MP tells him, you don't belong here. Mm-hmm. Because they are eating what?
Some money.
This is not the first time for politicians to be paid. Mm. But probably it is the first time that it becomes a matter of, it's normal. Mm. Okay? And what is abnormal is not to give them inducements.
Yes.
Okay? Mm-hmm. So, that one you didn't learn from us. As Dr. Latigo has just demonstrated, you have taught it to yourselves. Because unless you tell me that the Latigos and the Owanas were doing it. Mm. Recently, I made a confession on one of the TVs that in my young days in journalism, I accepted a bribe and killed the story. Mm. Now, instead of learning from my confession, because I confessed it, you young people thought I was encouraging you to do it also. Now you go and try it, you will see what happens. So we are not going to force you to learn from us. Mm. Look at a party like Democratic Party. It is not the first time DP is having wars within.
Yes.
But for the first time, their wars have, they are failing to manage their wars internally. Mm. And then they look for someone to blame. Mm. Always. Uh-huh. So where did you learn that from? Not from us.
Exactly.
So my thinking is that look at this parliament. Mm. You have General Moses Ali, who is older than Zake by over 50 years.
Yes.
Uh-huh. They are in the same parliament.
Yes.
And I'm not talking about Zake in particular, but the Zakes. Mm. In their minds, they think Moses Ali should get out. That preoccupies them. Mm. And then probably Moses Ali says, how did this come?
Mm.
Uh-huh. So we have grandparents, children,
parents, and children.
The children. Mm.
In the same house.
In the same thing. And we are failing to reconcile ourselves to that fact. You young people think that it is a profession to be young. You even think it is a calling.
It's a privilege.
Someone is telling you, says, "Totubulira, mwimuli bakadde." Correct. I can't have an argument about how old I am because I am old. But I wasn't born old. One time I had the white hair. Incidentally, I'm the Secretary General of the Association of the Bald-Headed and the,
and the Gray Hair,
of which General Tumwine was the president.
Yes.
And now that he's not around.
So you are.
And we haven't had
to stage
fresh
your
elections.
Yes.
No. I am just there.
We will get back to you.
Uh-huh.
Professor, I just want to bring you here in. We are seeing a new culture of politicians that seem to have a different, way of the how they approach politics. You've talked about how people were pushed and given money to have bills passed in parliament. Where did we go wrong? Did we just refuse to learn from you, as Tony Wana is talking about, or there are circumstances that have changed in our country and in our politics?
You are greedier than us.
Professor.
That's a huge question, and Tony talks about their association. Me and Mike Sebalu, we call ourselves the clear-headed. The baldness is clear-headed.
Then you will pass your hand like this. Clear-headed leader.
And that is the problem. We join politics with absolute clarity as to what our roles were. I used to move around with people like JJ Otim, Professor now Ambrose Okulu, and they would sit. There are times when they would send you to do something. There are other times when they would exclude you from their discussions. But you also learn that there are areas that don't belong to you by virtue of who you are, a young person who needs time to learn. There are also times to learn. Now, politics has unfortunately become sadly an opportunity. And an opportunity without substantive controls sucks in the worst in us. And therefore, the most crafty youth will outwit us. I mean, I lost the last election, not because Latigo was incompetent, but because I could not lie. It would be terrible for me to lie. How would I lie to win a vote?
You couldn't do the needful.
That is how bad it is. The issue now is not how we got here. How do we get out? That is what preoccupies my mind.
We will get to that. How do we get out of here? But Professor, I just want you to actually tell us, where exactly did this start? Where did we go wrong? So that, because we can't know how we get out before actually we know how we got into there.
We bastardized politics, you know, and unfortunately for Uganda, we never got out of this thing. NILPOS recently published an interview with me, and they asked me the comparison between the lessons we can draw from Kenyan politics. In Kenyan elections, you don't hear of opposition, you hear of parties and contestants. For us, our politics is opposition and us. And that is so destructive to our country. I am not opposition, I'm a Ugandan with a different perspective on the same challenge. Where can we get rid of this opposition versus us thing? And where there is good, it doesn't matter where it belongs. That good will remain good. Where there is bad, it doesn't matter where it belongs. Mm. It is bad wherever it is.
Yes.
So if we can now, we started even supporting somebody simply because we want our party to win, but we don't care who is contesting. And in the end, the crafty have taken over politics. The daredevils have taken over politics, and the mean are in charge. And every day, our generation, and it is good that we are discussing it with the loss of Yona and Ellie. That generation of ours, every day, regardless of what we do, we can never increase our percentage. No. Our percentage will continue to go down.
Correct.
And the space that will be left will be occupied by these people. Mm. So it is incumbent upon the few of us who are still left to see if we can restructure Ugandan politics so that we bequeath to this younger generation a politics that helps to further the greater interest of the country rather than self-interest.
Professor, before actually I let you go, we understand that at that time, or your generation, we used to even to have career politicians, people who were doing politics as a service to the people. You know, they just sacrifice for their country. Do those career politicians still have a place in today's Uganda?
Yes.
No, even our politicians of those days were not career politicians. You had the teachers becoming district councillors, and the law allowed a teacher to be a teacher and a district councillor. Mm. Now, the teacher was the epitome of progress, of hope, because they're the ones who molded people. But because they occupied both the political space and the education space, they upheld the moral standing that was required to build our country. Once we cut off civil servants from politics, that you cannot stand and remain a civil servant, you cannot stand and remain a teacher, who else do you have left?
Professor, I'll come back to you. Don't keep online. I'll come back to you. Let me just bring in Tony here. Tony, do career politicians still have a place in this Uganda today?
No, I think I am being guided by Professor Latigo now. Mm. A career politician is one who makes politics a calling.
Yes.
What else can you do in life apart from representing or leading people?
Mm-hmm.
I think that is harmful.
Yes.
And if it ever existed, then it must not be encouraged.
Mm.
Because once politics become your career in itself,
yes,
what is the investment that people will elect you in order to further their interests?
Mm.
No. I think it is important to first belong to them.
Exactly.
Like, why can't you, as a professor is saying, remain an entomologist in Makerere University while
you are a councillor at City Hall?
Or even an MP?
Yes.
So now,
so that you get so that you get your salary in Makerere.
Don't even talk about the salary. We must be paid for whatever we do.
Yes, not.
That's why I'm coming to you immediately from here, so that you. But
yes,
the important thing is, what else can you do apart from politics?
Yes.
Now today, I remember when we first had, and the professor will remember, the first resistance councils we had in 1987.
Yes.
You had people in Kitintale, they had RC1 leaders like the late Henry Kayondo, senior counsel. Mike Mokulas, Specioza Kazibu. These were the RC1. Now, gradually, it started being, let us vote for the one who has time.
For us.
Not for us. To be around the village. That means the jobless.
Yes, and drink with us.
Now, the jobless became the chairman because he's usually around. Then slowly the defense secretary became a fellow lumpen. And now,
the village became a village of.
We started saying whoever has a gate should not be voted for because those people are not accessible.
Yes.
You see the standards now? Now, you go to a place and you find that the LC1 chairman is queer.
He's not understandable.
He's the one.
He's the chairman.
He is the one. And those people are powerful. Now, we have left politics to those. Professor has just told you of someone who defeated him. Even the voters, in their heart of heart, they said, what have we done? But how do you think in a referendum between between Barabbas and Jesus?
We saw the voters of Luwero with Dr. Jesse Moyego.
In the Bible, there is a referendum on Barabbas and Jesus. They asked those fellows, who of these should we release? The fellows said, give us our rapist. So it is serious. But for me, all is not lost.
Yes.
Whatever its other ramifications might be, you watch out for what Mao is trying to tickle this government into doing.
Yes.
Just watch the space. Let's not disturb it if we don't like it or if we like it too much.
Yes.
But I can tell you, even this government of mine might need to be guided back to a certain course somewhere.
Yes.
That is one. Two, Mugabe's circumstances have forced me to work with you.
Yes.
Have we not enjoyed working together?
We've done.
Do you know how many years I'm older than you?
Not so many years.
Well, will you overtake by growing older?
Not, of course.
Now,
yes.
When I was born, the year in which I was born is when Drake Sekeba began journalism.
Yes.
I have worked with Drake.
Yes.
Now I'm working with you. When I started journalism, Jagenda Semakula, who is my professional next of kin, was in P1. Okay? How about Semyan was still moving with his parents somewhere inside? He hadn't even imagined. It was not even thought of. So for me, for example,
and when Semakula started journalism,
I shared my skills with you people.
Yes.
Okay? So even others have done the same, although they are not hard. What we mostly hear is noise. On social media here, you are likely to think that Tumwine was an ogre. But we have been silenced by the mob.
Yes.
Yes? I don't like to be brought into a program where I am the one representing Tumwine and you, that the others, like Professor is saying, opposition and we.
And we.
I also know Tumwine's failings, but when you invite me to studio to say you are the Tumwine person and this
I am, yes.
What are we doing?
Then actually we lose the direction.
So Tone, finally,
we just want to wrap up this whole conversation with Professor Latigo.
Let me thank Professor for a point he pointed out. While other countries have political parties that are looking for power, in Uganda we have NRM, NAFA opposition.
Exactly. Now, we already agree that there is something that went wrong between the politicians that we've had in the past and the politicians that we're having today. The question is, Tony, before I get back to Professor, where do we, how do we get out of this?
Mugabo, why do you say the politicians we had? We are still having them.
Not so many, but you are seeing a generation.
You don't need many.
You are seeing a generation of generalists, as you have said.
You are seeing
of Professor Latigo and the generation of the Senyonis, the Zake of this world.
You will not get out of it easily. Because for us, we are gradually saying goodbye. Okay? There is nothing we have not shown you. But what hasn't happened to you, you have not faced real problems to make you think of not inheriting something from some people, but creating something for yourselves. You want to succeed us, to take over.
By force.
But you are trying to overtake. Instead of waiting to take over, you are trying to overtake and blaming us for not dying quickly.
not dying quickly, retiring quickly.
But we retired. For example, on which payroll I am. I retired long, unless you are foolish enough to say I should stop doing journalism. We shall fight. I'll fight with you. How do you prevent professor from hunting his insects and studying them because he's no longer at market?
And writing papers.
So please, you have space to occupy, but you have this spirit of being given.
Professor Latigo, how do we get out of this whole bastardization of politics? Because we understand that the politicians or your crop of leaders, your generation did not have this kind of a bastardized political environment.
No, they were.
How do we
they
get out there. Of this?
They were there.
How do we get out of this, Professor?
Well, I personally, I want really to bequeath to the younger generation, a Uganda that imbues hope in everybody, trust in everybody, love in everybody. Where we are now, and when you go through social media, the hatred, the tension, the lack of respect is too much. So we have reached a stage where we as a country, we must find an urgent opportunity to come together and say, let us sit down and talk about everything, including what has happened, what is happening, and what should happen. Just that engagement alone, where everybody is involved, will bring down the tension and raise opportunity for rational thought and objective considerations to be made. And once those are made, we should then commit ourselves and make binding commitment that what we have generated out of this is like the Bible. Nobody is going to revise it, and we'll all go by it. And if we do that, I can assure you, people will be amazed at the things that will happen to our country. Our country is so blessed, is so endowed, but we are its worst enemy. So we cannot look for answers outside. We must look for answers within ourselves and create as urgently as possible opportunity for national dialogue, opportunity for national reconsideration, opportunity for national renewal. Because that, besides that, anything else is empty posturing. Whether you are talking about your strength as the youth or your strength as people who own the gun, it will not work. It is the spirit of the country that needs to be rebuilt.
Professor, before I let you go, are you retired now and you're no longer a member of the Forum for Democratic Change? Where are you now? Where do you belong now?
I am. I went back to being the Latigo before politics. I don't belong anywhere. I am available to help this country. To be honest with you, if I came to Kampala one day, I would walk with you in town, and you'll see. The borders would want to greet me. That is a huge resource. We go to Kabale, people will want to shake hands with me. You go to Karamoja, the same thing. So I consider myself a national resource. But that resource is useless unless there's an opportunity for it to be utilized. So I wait and keep praying that an opportunity will rise again when Latigo can play his part to ensure that a new foundation is set for the country.
Thank you so much, Professor Maurice Ogenga Latigo. I think
otherwise I'm here enjoying my family, and after here I'll just go to the gardens.
We heard some birds crying here.
Thank you so much, Professor Latigo. That has been Professor Maurice Ogenga Latigo, and here Tony Geoffrey Owana. We've been discussing the legacies of our, you know, previous politicians, or the older generation of politicians, and the new generation
for you.
of politicians. Yes. Mm-hmm.
In 1983, when we lost Major General David Oite Ojok, all people who were found playing music and looking happy suffered for it.
Why?
Today, yes. For me, I was irritated by the people celebrating. But when I remembered that these are some of the freedoms for which the Tumwines struggled, the ability to abuse soldiers, to beat policemen, and you get away with it.
Yes.
But that kind of peace is not the correct one. There was a person at Radio Uganda who played a program, a fira,
yes,
in when General Jok had died. And the song he played was Sauri Yako, Sauri Yako. Immediately, two Mercedes Benzes came and they picked up the managers.
Yeah.
And the vice president wanted to know which Sauri Yako are you talking about? You know? So now, when I have an MP who is leading others to abuse, and they get away with it. But let me warn you, it is only we who can tolerate that. The Mugabos
may not tolerate
that.
Thank you so much, Tony Geoffrey Owana. Thank you so much for watching The Rush Hour and The Big Issue. We've been discussing the future of career politicians here in Uganda, but also making a comparison between the generation, the older generation of the politicians, and also the current generation, or the young generation of politicians we are having today. With me has been Tony Geoffrey Owana, veteran journalist, and also joining us from Agago District, former leader of the opposition, Professor Maurice Ogenga Latigo. We've been discussing that, and the discussion continues. The Rush Talk returns with a much more discussion on how better to uphold the legacies that have been left behind, the departed older generations of our leaders. Maiz Ramitu will be joined by the former East African Legislative Assembly Speaker, Margaret Nantongo Ziwa. We are taking a break. We are returning in a short while.